Samson actually found a girl and he kind of liked her, so he went to his parents and she was a Philistine woman. Samson is an Israelite. So he comes and tells his parents that, I want to marry this girl. And they were not too happy about it for a number of reasons, and we'll go there. But and they were like, can't you find someone in our, among our own people? And here's the verse that follows. It says, his parents did not know that this was from the Lord, who was seeking an occasion to confront the Philistines. And so I want to start off, maybe if I give a title today, I want to say, when God picks a fight. And so to give you a background, we have to go into Judges chapter 13. And the first few verses will show us that there was a man and a woman, and they were barren. And Samson's mother was visited by an angel of the Lord. And let's go there to the thing. She was visited by an angel of the Lord, and an angel appeared to her totally unexpected. She was barren. The angel appears to her and tells her that she's going to have a son. But he also gives some instructions saying what kind of child this will be. The angel of the Lord appeared to her and said, you are sterile and childless, but you are going to conceive and have a son. Wait there for a minute. Now notice, the angel came and he was fully aware of what her situation was. God always knows. And he says, yes, I know this is what is right now, but this is what I'm going to do with you. The message was that I know your situation is terrible, but I'm going to do a miracle in your life. I'm paraphrasing. I'm going to do a miracle in your life. You're going to have a child. And then gives her instructions how she needs to respond, how she needs to respond to this word so that this child will be born and brought up in the right way. And verse 5 says, there is a specific instruction that he needs to be brought up as a Nazarite. So Nazarite, if you look at the Old Testament, we're not going to go there. There was specific, in the book of Numbers, you'll find Numbers chapter 6. But there's a specific do's and don'ts for the Nazarites. It was a special vow when people dedicated themselves to the Lord for a season. And the Nazarite vow actually demanded that they separate themselves unto the Lord, and that, you know, they can't, no razor can touch their hair, they don't drink anything fermented, no wine, and they are, that whole period, they can't touch a dead body, and there's many other things. So, but they were separated unto the Lord. It was not just like, don't do this, and don't do this, and don't do this. It was, you're not doing this because the whole time you're going to be wholly, completely dedicated to the Lord for his cause and for his purpose. So people used to take that Nazarite vow. Now for Samson, the instruction was that all his life he's going to be a Nazarite. So stay pure and stay separated, that because there was a purpose of God. And look at what the purpose of God was over his life. Set apart to God from birth, and he will begin the deliverance of Israel from the hand of the Philistines. That was the purpose for which God had already planned, that this child, miracle child, he is going to be set apart for this purpose, that he will start the deliverance of the Israelites from the hands of the Philistines. Young man, Samson, goes down to hang out with some friends, and by the way, there he sees this girl, and then he likes her. So he comes and he tells his parents, this is the one. This is the route I want to take. This is what I want to do. And what did his parents say? Son, paraphrase again. You're supposed to be a Nazarite. You can't mix with the uncircumcised Philistines. You can't do this. Can't you find, like, we have gazillions of girls here. Come on, there's many fish in the sea here. Why do you have to go there? Okay, that's my version of it. But they were actually genuinely concerned about his well-being. Here it is that they've brought up a child in the right way. These are the things to do. This is the way to go. This is how you are to behave. This is what God has for you. And so they did everything they know to do. And one fine day, he comes to them and says, I want that one. So I want you to look at a parallel, right? What do you do when the promised one, or the promises of God that you've nurtured for years? So this can be a child, it can be a spouse, it can be a situation, it doesn't have to be a person. I just wanted to take a prophetic parallel here. So what do you do when you fed into the promises of God, when you have carefully guarded over the word of God and you have had an expectation and you have, you know, the history of God to back you up, and then all of a sudden it stares you back in the face, and then this situation comes up and it's just the opposite of what you'd ever wanted. Now, mind you, Samson was set apart for a specific purpose, and the purpose was to finish the Philistines. But here he was, they were their enemies, here he was saying the very thing that he was anointed to finish, he wanted to be in covenant with. He wanted to walk with them. He wanted to have a relationship with them. So basically the situation was of the sleeping with the enemy. And so chapter 14 verse 4, I want you to now look at it again. Here is a fed and nourished promise of God. But all of a sudden, there's the bomb drop. But there is a little side note that God is giving. In the word it says, his parents did not know that this was from the Lord, who was seeking an occasion to confront the Philistines. Now, brothers and sisters, I want you to think of something. God had said, I'm going to use you to finish the Philistines. He had said, I want you to stay set apart. Don't mingle with the uncircumcised. That was part of the law. And somewhere along the line, Samson's heart got drawn away. However that happened, and I want to say, by the way, God can use even the deviations of our heart, our mistakes, our weaknesses. He doesn't make us do that, but he can use it and redeem it. Are you hearing me? So here was Samson, and if you look at Samson's life and history, Delilah was not the only lady that he slept with. He always had a weakness for women, and he always seemed to get drawn to the wrong women. That's just a postscript. But if you know Samson's history, that's what. So it starts off by him doing exactly opposite of what God. God wanted him to kill the Philistines. He wanted to get into a covenant with the Philistines. A marriage covenant. But P.S., God was behind that whole thing. His parents were getting worried and fretting and fuming and thinking, oh God, where did we go wrong? Where did we miss it? Did I not dedicate him to you? Did I not do everything I knew to do? Did I not discipline him? Did I not teach him the way of the Lord? Everything that you said we've done, what happened? Where did I fail? And probably the friends were there snickering and saying, you didn't want to send him to our parties, huh? Now look. But God was seeking an occasion to confront. Actually, other versions, you should read it. It says God was looking for a fight. Come on. God was looking to pick a fight with the devil, with the enemy. And so he takes advantage of this situation. God can redeem our situations. I know this is kind of like, I don't know. But you know what? I didn't make it up. This is what the word of God says. It was a nasty situation, but God's hand was in it. It was a messy situation, but God's hand was in it. It seemed in every way contradictory to the word of God. Looks like, didn't God say not to do this? Now you're saying God made him do this? No, God didn't make him do it, but God is big enough to take all of the evil inclinations of our heart, take all of our weaknesses, mistakes, and sin, and everything, and take an occasion to confront the enemy, to finish him off in our own lives, and also in the grand scheme of things. The Spirit of the Lord began to stir him while he was in Mahanedan. This is before he actually saw the girl. So he had already had experience with God. He had a genuine experience with God. The Spirit of God was already working and stirring in his heart. If you look at different versions, it says in different ways. So God was already working in him, on him. The Spirit of God was moving him and stirring him. So he had a relationship with God. He had an experience with God. He was stirred up with the things of God. And yet, there was a certain area of weakness in his life. However, that area of insecurity or weakness came, but he had set his mind in the wrong path. He deviated. Let's face it. I'm glad these things are written in the scriptures, so we don't make everything rosy. I'm glad there were, you know, people who were not perfect in the Bible. Because God always shows that regardless of what our weakness or our sin is, if we repent and if we turn around, if we just give ourselves to God, God is able to redeem that situation. Not just to make it a blessing for us, but also to use us for the advancing of His kingdom. To make us a blessing to many people. I would want you to know, in case you didn't know, that at this situation when Samson came on the scene, the Israelites had already been captives under the Philistines for over 20 years. 20 years of being overruled, 20 years of being being oppressed by the Philistines. After 20 years, God was actually looking for someone that He can use as a weapon against the enemy. God was looking for a leader. God was looking for someone who He can use to bring reformation among the backslidden Israelites. Remember, according to the word of the Lord, every time the Israelites walked with the Lord, they obeyed the word of the Lord, they kept themselves pure before God, they prospered. Things went well. And every time they disobeyed and they did things that were not right, they had other people oppress them. God allowed it. That discipline came. So this was a time, a season of 20 years when Israelites had walked away. This happened after Jephthah and a few other judges had come. They didn't have kings by then. But they had sinned and they were in that judgment period, 20 years being oppressed by the Philistines. Now God was looking, how can I bring a change? How can I bring revival? Who can I use to confound the enemy and to bring revival in the Israel camp or among the Israelites? And so here was Samson, called, dedicated. Listen, here's one thing. The purposes of the Lord will stand firm forever. Many are the thoughts in the heart of man. Many are the paths that we take. But the Lord's purposes will stand firm forever. Every prayer that has been prayed will be answered. Every word that proceeded from the mouth of God will be fulfilled. Even when there are periods and moments when people deviate from that. There may be a season when people go away from it. There may be a season of rebellion. There may be a season of sin. But God is faithful. God is faithful to His word. So in the Samson situation, God was the one who, even before he was born, He said, I will use him to start finishing the Philistines. So the situation looks really contradictory. So I want you to think of any situation in your life. Here in Samson's case, I'm thinking of his parents. As a parent, I can think, like, you know, this was a child that was born with prophetic word, and now he's saying he wants to sleep with the enemy, the very people he's supposed to kill. They might have been heartbroken. Forget Samson's thing. Think about any situation in our lives. I've been there, where at times it looks like the prophetic words, the promises of God stare you in the face, and then the situation or the facts of life stare you right back, and it doesn't match. It doesn't match. What God called, or what God said, or what, you know, people prophesied over you, what you knew in your heart, what the word of God says, doesn't match up with the reality or the facts in your life. It looks completely different. What do you do? I suggest to you, maybe go back to your closet, go on your knees, and ask God, is there something else going on, Lord? Because you are always faithful and true. And maybe God is looking for another occasion to confound the enemy. And maybe God is doing something. He is always a person of strategy. He has a strategy. If we can just find in our hearts to trust God regardless of what the situation is like. So you'll find here, actually, if you go down in chapter 14. His parents agree, like, you know, and so he gets engaged to this girl, but it's a story of betrayal. He's betrayed, he's alone, he's devastated, he's lost the very thing that he was going after. But how did God redeem it? I wanted to see it. God redeemed it because it says Samson was so mad with these people that he goes and kills 30 and then 300, and then so let's look at what happens and how God uses and brings his word to pass. The Spirit of the Lord came upon him in power. He went down to Ashkelon, struck down 30 of their men. This is of the Philistine men, okay? Stripped them of their belongings and gave their clothes to those who had explained the riddle. So you can read the story, but basically he started attacking the Philistines. Before that, he was living a complacent life. Okay, before that, even though the Spirit of God had stirred his heart several times, before that, even though he was dedicated for the work of the Lord, before that, even though he knew the purpose of God over his life, he was flirting with the enemy. He knew he was called for this. He knew he was empowered, but he really didn't have any motivation. He had not stepped into his destiny. He had chosen to just stay there. And then he saw this pretty girl and he thought, well, I know I'm supposed to finish the Philistines, but hey, it's just a pretty girl. She's not really all that bad. And so, but God used that situation of disobedience, that situation of shame, and that situation God uses. So he starts off by killing 30 of the Philistines. Then let's look at chapter 15, verse 3. He starts getting more and so God is making an inroad into his heart through the devastating situation. It says, Samson said to them, "This time I have a right to get even with the Philistine. I will really harm them." See, he didn't get motivated to step into his destiny when nothing was going wrong. Now, his dream was shattered. Now, he had chosen a wrong path and he was bearing the consequence of it. But God was using that and his emotions were all stirred up. He says, now I'm going to really finish them off. He was really ticked off with the Philistines. And so, each time they would do something to him, he would get angry. So, it's all coming in, you know, one after the other, what they would do to him, and okay, let's go to 15, 4 and 5. So this is the famous story of where he catches the foxes and sets their tails on fire. But I want you to notice, because we get so caught up with the story of how Samson set the foxes' tails on fire. Like, okay, if you don't know, he catches foxes and ties their tails together. Who in their right mind does this? I don't know, but anyway, he does this, sets it on fire, and releases them into the harvest field of the Philistines. You have to understand, this is an agricultural age. Their harvest is everything for them. So they lose their harvest, they lose their vineyards. He got so annoyed with them that he not only killed those 30 people, then he says, I'll take your harvest. I'm going to make sure that you go hungry. I'm going to make sure that you feel the pain of what you've done to me. Now see, God wanted to do this to the Philistines to get them to leave and go. Get them to let go of the Israelites. To take revenge on what they had done on his people. But since he would not step up, God used Samson's own weakness because he would not step up. God used it to get him ticked off, irritated. But however, keep that verse in mind. His parents didn't know this was of the Lord because God was looking for an occasion to confound the enemy. Let's look at verse 7 and 8 of chapter 15. Now, this is after the Philistines killed the girl that he liked. Okay? He was engaged to her. After the Philistines killed, because when he set their things on fire, they set her and her father's household on fire and they died. So now he says, since you've acted like this, I won't stop until I get my revenge on you. God had to still bring him to the place where a little bit of vengeance wasn't enough. It was a mission of his life to finish the Philistines. So as things escalated, he said, okay, now you've really ticked me off. I will not stop until I get my full vengeance on you. Now look at verse 15 of chapter 15. So he had 30 people killed. Then he got their vineyards and olive groves and grain all destroyed. Then he said, I'm just going to not stop until I do this. Now look, it comes to a place where they came to attack him. And you know, Samson, he had the strength of the Lord. Finding a fresh jawbone of a donkey, he grabbed it and struck down 1,000 men. And this is referring to the Philistines, if you see in the story. So from 30, now he was so determined, he said, you ain't resting until I finish all of you off. He takes 1,000 men and they're out. So he starts, he was actually propelled into the purpose of God. Through his own weakness, but because God was committed to what he was doing. Samson had to go through some mess, some pain, some consequences of his bad choices. But I'm trying to say that God's word will still be fulfilled. that there are times when God is looking for what he wants fulfilled. And as long as, see, here's the thing, the prayers of the parents was there. It was weighty. The word of the Lord was there over Samson's life. It was weighty. So here, chapter 16 finds Samson again sleeping with the enemy. So there's Delilah. And then, you know, she's nagging and she's trying to find what's the secret of his strength. She was bribed by the Philistines wanting to kill Samson. And finally, he tells her the secret. And so fast forwarding the story, you all know, he says, the secret is in my hair. If my hair is cut. Now see, it wasn't about the hair. It was about the covenant that he had made with the Lord. So he, when he says, okay, the secret is in my hair, when you cut the hair, because a Nazirite was not supposed to have his hair cut. So when the hair was cut, so Delilah calls these people, the leaders of the Philistines, and they come, and while he's sleeping, he has the most expensive haircut in the world because he lost the anointing. Right? So he wakes up a weak man. And then you'll see how the Philistines take him, they imprison him. They gouge out his eyes. It's quite gory if you read. And they set him to grind in the prison. So from the little boy who was prophesied about, who was dedicated, whose parents had given all that they knew to do and had brought him up in the ways of the Lord, and the Lord had put his mark and seal upon him. But because of his wrong choices, here was Samson, blind, lost his strength, lost his anointing. In fact, the word of God says the Spirit of God had left him and he didn't even know it. The same Samson who had torn apart a lion, who had killed 1,000 men, all of that goes on his resume by barehandedly, you know, he did that. But here he is grinding, blind and weak. And then I want you to see, but the story doesn't end there. God was still looking for an occasion to fulfill his word. And Samson was a weapon in God's hand. Regardless of Samson's disobedience, regardless of how he, you know, here's the thing though, there's always a consequence for sin. But God is greater than all of that. And what is the secret? The Philistines seized him, gouged out his eyes and took him down to Gaza, binding him with bronze shackles. They set him to grinding in the prison. Now watch verse 22. But the hair on his head began to grow again after it had been shaved. Listen, but the hair on his head began to grow. There was a season of shame and pain and all of that, but God was still working in the background. His hair started to grow. It's just symbolic of his strength returning. It is just symbolic of the season changing. That season of disgrace, that season of shame, the season of mistake was changing, and now he was regaining his strength. Now go to verse 25. So the enemy now was thinking, okay, now we've got this guy. We are going to make fun of him. And it says in verse 25, while they were in high spirits, they shouted, bring out Samson to entertain us. Right? So they called Samson out of the prison and he was performing for them. Maybe he was carrying heavy weight and lifting things, I don't know. And then it says, when they stood him among the pillars, Samson said to the servant, put me where I can feel the pillars so that I may lean against them. Now this was the strategy that he was saying. But we all know the story, but I wanted to look at another scripture. Look at verse 27 of chapter 16. It says, the temple was what? Crowded with men and women. All the rulers of the Philistines were there, and on the roof were about 3,000 men and women watching Samson perform. Listen, this was a total setup. The enemy thought, okay, let's bring him out and make fun of him. Look at the blind Samson, look at the weak Samson. Now we're going to make you perform for us. But God had set it up in such a way. He said, okay, Samson is blind now. He's made a mistake. He's weak. And they've got this plot against Samson. But God was looking for an occasion. He said, all right, we'll do it your way, but I win. God was saying, okay, you planned this, but I declare overruled. God was saying, I'll get all of them out. So here now, from the 30 people to the 300 people to all of the destruction of the other things, Samson was being, and 1,000 men he killed, and now here was 3,000 people. And look who were there. All the rulers. These were the very people who were oppressing Israelites. So it says all the rulers of the Philistines were there. And the prominent women, probably the other three women that Samson had, you know, relationships with. You know, including Delilah and the other woman. And maybe they were all there. We don't know. But the rulers were there. So God gathers them under this place according to their own plan. And then we know the story, what Samson does. The end of the story says that, you know, they all died. We know Samson pushes the pillar. Come on, everybody knows that story, right? And it all falls on them. They die. But what happened? Why? And the Bible says that Samson killed more people in the end than he did in all. When I say more people, it's talking about the Philistines, okay? More of the enemies of God in the end than he did all through his lifetime. Even as a judge, he was a judge for several years. But Samson killed more in the end. He did more. He ended up with a big bang. He didn't fizzle out. But there was a secret to that. Look at the next verse. Look at verse 28. How did he finish well? Samson prayed to the Lord, O sovereign Lord, remember me. Strengthen me. Let me take revenge on my enemies. See, God was able to use whatever little he had. But the secret was that Samson prayed to the Lord. He turned to the Lord. He said, God, remember me. Remember me. Because when God, not that God forgot ever, but what he was saying was a reminder for himself. God, do you remember that you had said that I was anointed to take out the Philistines? Do you remember you said I was the set apart one? Do you remember my history with you? So he goes back to God and turns to God, and God uses that situation. And we know in the New Testament, Hebrews chapter 11 says that Samson made it among the great men of faith.